And he said, now we're going to start our questioning. I'll begin with to Dr. Binkley and Dr. Zachariah. Earlier this year, I think you were watching in several of our committee, Senate committees, deliberated the role of the innovation of strengthening U.S. competition globally. It was the China Challenge, we'd call it, as you know. The committee had recently passed in its Energy Act of 2020, and we contributed to the dialogue this spring by championing the role of the DOE and the national labs as central to federal investment and innovation across the broad range of technologies. The resulting bill, the U.S. Innovation and Competition Act, includes an authorization for $16.9 billion new dollars in funding for research and development activities at DOE. So given this additional funding authorization, where do you see the greatest need and opportunity? Where do you all intend to invest it? And how should we expect our returns on investment? Dr. Binkley first, and Dr. Zachariah.
Okay. thank you, Chairman Manchin. So, we're looking at numerous areas where investments could be made and have the most impact in innovation, and they would include areas in quantum information science and microelectronics, in systems biology, essentially across the whole range of these, what we consider to be critical and emerging technologies. These technologies will open the door to essentially new businesses, and there are significant research opportunities in these areas as well. We also need to invest in the scientific infrastructure to support those activities. And in the case of, for example, quantum information science, there's a need for construction of facilities that can fabricate quantum devices and so on. Also, in the microelectronics area, there are significant advances that could be made in advanced lithography. And investments in those areas, I think, would be very, very key to the U.S. economy.
Thank you. Dr. Zachariah?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To amplify what Dr. Binkley said, I think the science enterprise, as you've heard, relies on the strong partnership between the national laboratories, academia, and industry. And as such, the national laboratories and DOE's Office of Science plays an important role in spanning that gap between foundational research that occurs both in academia as well as the national laboratories, and translating into applications and societal impact through partnership with industry. I think as Dr. Binkley mentioned, there are a number of areas where continued investments in research activities is key to provide the solutions that are necessary to address some of the critical problems that faces humanity, and particularly for us as a nation to compete with the rest of the world. Equally important is to sustain the world-leading capabilities of the national laboratories in order to continue to operate them in a reliable fashion, making it available for industry and academia, and also the necessary investment and support for in the new scientific and upgrade of scientific facilities that have been essentially recommended by the scientific community through FACA committees to the Department of Energy, and has been recognized and supported by Congress. I'll just give you an example. I touched on this earlier.
Doctor, if I could, if I may, because I know our time is very, we all have limited time here, but if I could ask you, I think what's very important to all of us as senators who might not realize the role that the labs have played in helping us to advance a vaccine, working in collaboration with pharmaceuticals and equipment that we have invested in over the years. Can you both briefly give us a snippet of what you all have done to accelerate this, for us to have a virus that attacked this country and attacked the world, for us to be able to come up as quickly as we did with a vaccine and the role that the DOE, the labs played?
So I would like
Dr. Brinke?
Yeah, I would like to comment on that.
Sure.
Mr. Chairman. So one of the key steps in getting to a new vaccine is understanding the detailed molecular structure of the virus itself. And so one of the major contributions that was made by the Office of Science was using the light sources and neutron sources at our various labs, we were able to very, very rapidly characterize the very detailed nature of the molecular structure of the virus.
What was the time frame that you were notified of this, that we had this virus coming upon us? Do you remember?
Well, for us, the turning point was when the CARES Act funding was appropriated.
Okay, March.
That enabled us to instantly turn on the research for characterizing the molecular structure of the virus. And that was in the March time frame.
March 2020.
Right. We were aware of the pending crisis maybe a month before that, seeing the infection rate increase. But we're hamstrung to do the research that was needed because obviously we have to have appropriated funds in order to do that.
Dr. Zachariah?
I would just add, Senator, that in addition to the light sources and the neutron sources, the Office of Science and its laboratories made its considerable capabilities in high-performance computing to both university and industry and other agency researchers to also scan through the compounds of available drugs to come up with solutions and new drugs to that are capable of attacking this virus.
Let me just say to all of you that there was not a bit of pushback for us to get the $16.9 billion carved out for our labs because of the applied science that you all have been doing and the great success you've had. So we know that you'll invest it wisely, and we're going to stay ahead of this curve so we don't have another virus creep up on us. We want to be ahead of it and be ready for it when it does come. Thank you all. Senator Bryce. So to any or all of you, how close are we to achieving technologies needed to capture and utilize carbon dioxide, not just to sequester it underground, but to use it as a value-added waste product? Doctor? Anybody? Please. Yes.
Senator, thank you for the question. Obviously, carbon is a valuable source that can be converted to a number of practical applications. Both coal refuse as well as carbon that have been captured that can then be converted to perhaps low-cost carbon fiber applications as well as other valuable products. Obviously, there is quite a bit of research that is going on in this area, as well as where we are working with industry to begin to start thinking about scale up. An important area would be things like graphene, as well as carbon electrodes, where again, there are some important activities that are going on.
Doctor, I know that you all were involved in the 80s, the Clean Air Act, with SOx and NOx and particulates and bag houses and all the things that we were able to do to clean up the environment, basically by coal-fired plants, many of them in my state. And with that, now we have, then CO2 came that became the great challenge. We came up with carbon capture, sequestration, utilization. But basically, we figured out that we could take clearstream carbon off. We could basically liquefy it. We could pressurize it and put it in the ground. But it was very, very costly. And unless there's going to be an added value to that, unless you have enhanced oil recovery, which we don't have, or pipelines to transport CO2, which is very challenging, it basically eliminates this type of tremendous amount of energy that's produced for our country. And if we do that in such a hastily way, we have no way of being energy independent. And the transition, until we have that transition, which is going on now, is going to put us in a perilous situation. That's what I'm concerned about. I know the transition's coming. We understand that. But with that, are we prepared? Or are we basically not doing enough? Because I would have thought by now we could have at least found a way to solidify it, use it as a byproduct in the building blocks, if you will, in the chain, that we just haven't gotten there yet. I have another question, too. Where are we on developing the technologies that would eliminate any type of methane escape from our drilling process or our production of natural gas? Because we know it's a tremendous harmful element to our environment. And I thought that we had that pretty much under control. But I'm understanding there's still an awful lot of methane escape when we're drilling and extracting. And really, if we've had that technology, do you know, any of you? Doctor, would you know about that, what you all have done, or any of the labs have done on that? Mr. Blinkley?
So there is work going on in the labs in that area. It's a pretty vexing problem, though, because, you know, the fugitive emissions from sources like that, a lot of the control really has to be taken at the source. You know, it's not a scientific problem. It's more of an engineering problem.
Yeah. I mean, in the eastern part of the United States, we do an awful lot of capturing. Out west, they haven't. And the reason I found out, they can't get permits for pipelines to take the methane off. So is it kind of a situation to where they want to be having that in a situation where they have a way to beat on it, if you will, and stop all drilling on BLM lands and things of this sort? We need production of energy. And the new technologies coming on, I'm all for renewables. I'm all for storage. I'm all for all of this. But I'm not for accelerating getting rid of what's gotten us to where we are today and keeps us energy independent. And there's a proper transition that should go on. And I want to make sure that we don't accelerate that to the point of our own detriment. That's my concern. And I don't know if we're moving. How do we get so quickly to SOx and NOx? How do we have scrubbers? You know, I grew up in a time with all the power plants around us where I grew up, and my parents had a hard time putting her washout. I remember all those days. That went by the wayside. By the 90s, we were out of that. All we had was this vapor. But with that, there was CO2 going up, carbon into the air, and they wanted to say, okay, now let's get rid of that too. We haven't made very much advances from the 90s to present. In the last 20 years, as quickly as we did with SOx and NOx, and particulates of mercury. We put a lot of money to you all.
Yes, sir.
Doctor, do you have anything you like to say on this? How come we have hit a milestone that we're not advancing our technology as quickly as we did with the Clean Air Act back in the 80s and 90s?
Senator, my comment is more on the use of coal, for example, around the material science and other applications that it can bring. And so we have a very active research program in the School of Energy Resources at the University of Wyoming. So it's not necessarily as useful in the future as an energy source, but it may have many, many other values that could be brought to
bear.
We
know that. In West Virginia, I'll just leave it. I'll stop at this. West Virginia has just basically patented a microchip made out of carbon. It's not going to be manufactured in a sterile environment. It's low cost. It seems to have good conductivity. Everyone seems to think it's going to work and work excellent because you can see the chip shortages we have right now. So we're looking at some of that. We're also showing on a commercial scale that we can take rare earth minerals out of the waste stream from coal. So we have an awful lot of that in the eastern part of the United States, especially, that we can basically recover an awful lot of material that we now are dependent upon foreign supply chains. So there's so much that can be done, and we need to advance this as quickly as possible. With that, I'm going to turn to Senator Bras. So just finally, I want to say thank you to all three of you for appearing today, and it was very enlightening. I would just say this. How close are you all coordinating, especially for our labs, with NSF, National Science Foundation? And I think you all are probably aware that we just invested with this new competitive bill we have, the Endless Frontier, $22 billion for the tech directorate. You all should, you know, we're talking about EBSCOR and everything else. It seemed like it was a natural, you know, we're not going to try to reinvent the wheel here. We want to make sure we just get the wheel more efficient. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how close you all are talking. Is there any coordination going on between your labs and NSF?
Well, the coordination, Senator, is done primarily between the federal side of the Office of Science and the other agencies that are involved.
So we'll talk to DOE then, basically the DOE?
It's DOE talking to NSF, talking to NIH and so on.
You all, on your level, it hasn't come down to you yet is what you're saying?
No, it's at my level.
Okay.
And let me pick on quantum information science as an example. We have very, very close coordination between ourselves, between DOE, which includes both the Office of Science and the National Nuclear Security Administration, because there's work on quantum done in that side. So we have coordination with the National Science Foundation, with Department of Defense. We have mid-level to senior managers from the across the, those agencies that meet regularly. We have annual program manager meetings where we get all of the QIS program managers from across the government together to go through what, you know, each person is doing, what they're funding, what their priorities are.
And let me just make, let me make sure that I think between myself and Senator Barrasso, Mike pretty much feels the same way. We want to make sure that's not redundant. We want to make sure that we're not creating silos. We want to make sure that the money that the American people are investing through our Treasury is going to get a return on that investment. That means basically getting the maximum use of what we already have.
Absolutely, okay. Sir. And that's exactly what we're trying to do. And we do that in the machine learning AI area.
Well, we're going to bring, we'll bring you back frequently to keep us updated on how you're doing.
Yes, sir. Okay? I'd be glad to do that.
Okay. Let me thank you.